Welcome to NetVN channel. If you only have one server in your organization, you are always worried about data loss. Your organization's work will be interrupted when the connection to the server is lost, the server is down, the server is powered down. And that's why your organization should have two servers to overcome the above risks. In this video I have two servers. One is named SV1 and has IP address 192.168.1.254. This is the main server. The other server is named SV2 and has an IP address of 192.168.1.253. This is a backup server. If the primary server goes down, the other server will function as the primary server and your organization's business will function as if nothing happened. That is the wish of any organization. First of all, I turn the SV1 server into a domain controller. My domain name is netvn local. After upgrading the SV1 server to a domain controller, I set the DNS address to the IP address of the SV1 server. Next, I will map between IP address and host name to make sure client computers can use alternate host name for IP address. Then I set up Google's DNS address so that the client computers can connect to the internet. Domain controllers help you manage resources, users, groups, and set policies that are right for your organization. In this video, I create a new organizational unit called Chicago. In there, I create a new group named Sales, and in this group, there is a member named Sarah. Groups, users, policies will be synced to the second server. In the next step, any changes made on the SV1 server will be synced to the SV2 server. In this case, the group named Sales, the user named Sarah will be automatically synced to the SV2 server. I have basic setup for SV1 server as primary domain controller. Next, I set up the SV2 server so that it syncs the data from the SV1 server to settings such as users, groups, organizational units. I set up the SV2 server to join the NetVN local domain that was set up on the SV1 server. When the SV1 server has a problem, SV2 server will take over, then everyone log in to the domain as usual. After setting data like group named Sales, user named Sarah will automatically sync to SV2 server. I installed Active Directory services on the SV2 server just like on the SV1 server. After installing Active Directory services, I also turn the SV2 server into a domain controller, but it will be different from the SV1 server. The SV2 server does not create a new domain, but joins an existing domain, which is netvn local. Here you set up the SV2 server to repeat the settings of the SV1 server. Once the setup is done, the SV2 server will reboot to complete. I will double check the groups, the users to make sure the data is replicated from the server SV1. Already have a group named Sales and the user is Sarah. Thus the data has been replicated successfully. But I want to make sure it works, so I use a client to join this domain. On the client computer, I set up the DNS address as the IP address of the SV1 server and the IP address of the SV2 server. As in this example, SV1 server IP address is 192.168.1.254, SV2 server IP address is 192.168.1.253. After setting up the DNS address, I set up my Windows 11 computer to join the netvn local domain. I'm logged into the domain with Sarah's user. Now I use the ping command to test the connection to the two servers. So after using the ping command, I know that both servers are working fine. Assuming the SV1 server loses connection, will Sarah be able to log into the domain? Let's wait for that to happen and check the results. I logged out of Sarah's account and powered off the SV1 server. The SV1 server is the primary server and the SV2 server is the repeat server. SV1 server was powered down. Now from Windows 11 client, I log in with Sarah's user. Great, the SV2 server did its job well. It replaced the SV1 server that was losing connection. SV2 server helps Windows 11 client to log in successfully. I use the ping command to test the connection to two servers. Windows 11 client loses connection to SV1 server but has connection to SV2 server. But how to sync files and folders? That's the purpose of the next part of this video. The first is to set up on the SV1 server. The purpose of this step is to build the file server system. Files and folders on the SV1 server are automatically duplicated on the SV2. This ensures data is backed up when the hard drive on the SV1 server fails. Or make sure users connect to their data when they lose connection to the file server SV1. When something goes wrong, the SV2 server replaces the SV1 server and becomes the file server. Work in your organization will not be interrupted. On the SV1 server, I install DFS namespaces and DFS replication. Before setting up the file server, you need to make sure DFS namespaces and DFS replication are installed on both the SV1 and SV2 servers. On the SV2 server, I finish installing DFS namespaces and DFS replication. Thus, both servers have installed the necessary components to set up the file server. In this part, you just need to set up on the SV1 server, the SV2 server will automatically be set up. Next, I set up DFS namespaces. It gives users in your organization access to shared folders regardless of which server they are located on. In this example, I create a namespace named Chicago. On the SV1 server, I create a new folder called Chicago on the dpartition. Next, I set read and write permissions for everyone, so everyone can discover this folder over the network. To access the shared folder, you use the domain name instead of the host name or IP address. Group and user permissions will be set to subfolders of the folder named Chicago. I have set up namespaces for SV1 server. Next, I will add SV2 server for namespaces named Chicago. On the SV2 server, I create a new folder called Chicago on the dpartition. Next, I set read and write permissions for everyone to this folder. Same as set up on SV1 server. So I have set up DFS namespaces. Next, I set up the data to be duplicated. The purpose of this step is so that shared files and data are synchronized between the two servers. Here I set up the data in the folder named Chicago will sync back and forth between the two servers SV1 and SV2. I add both servers to the list. Next is to choose the topology and bandwidth. The default options are the ones I recommend. Of the two servers, I choose SV1 as the main server. Next, I set up the directory to be replicated on the SV1 server. As mentioned, I will be replicating the data to a folder named Chicago located in the dpartition. The data in the Chicago directory on the SV1 server will be replicated in the Chicago directory in the dpartition on the SV2 server. And here is a summary of my settings, which seems to be exactly what I wanted. Everything seems fine. I will create a new file to check the result. In the folder called Chicago on the SV1 server, I created a new plain text file. To make sure the settings are applied, I restart the DFS namespaces service and restart the DFS replication service. I expect the files to be synced on the SV2 server. On the SV2 server, I also restarted the DFS namespaces service and restarted the DFS replication service. Next, on the SV2 server, I go to the folder called Chicago and the dpartition. It's great that the file is synced. Thus, the data is automatically synchronized from the SV1 server to the SV2 server. But that's on servers. What about client computers? I will test on a Windows 11 client. I access the shared folder using the domain netvn local, and the shared folder is named Chicago. From the client, I successfully access the shared folder. So I have successfully built the file server and have the data synchronized between the two servers. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Hopefully this will help your organization run smoothly and you don't have to worry when the server loses connection or the server goes down. If you want to set permissions for each group, you create separate folders for each group. Then set permissions for each group for that group's folder. Like here, I create a new folder named Sales for the group named Sales. For this folder, only members of the Sales group etc. can access this folder. Members of other groups cannot access this folder.